ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रुण्वन् नूतिभिः सेदः सादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक्प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथोपलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदम् मामा ब्रह्म निराकरोत् अनिराकरणमस्त्व निराकरणं मेऽस्तु तदात्मनिरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्माः सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः नाहं मन्ये सुवेदेति नो न वेदेति वेद च यो नस्तद्वेद तद्वेद नो न वेदेति वेद च यदेव अन्यदेव तद्विदिता तथो अविदितादधि इत्युक्तं तदेव वस्तु अनुमान अनुभवाभ्यां संयोज्य निश्चितं वाक्यांतरेण नो न वेदेति वेद च आचार्य सेड अन्यदेव तत् विदितात् अथो अविदितात् अधि आगम द स्टूडेंट ही रिसीव्ड द आगम मीन्स ही लिसेंड टू इट ही ड्वेल्ट अपॉन इट अनुमान एंड ही एसिमिलेटेड इट साक्षात्कार सो अनुभव इज द साक्षात्कार Aparokshanubhuti, there is a book written by Shankara, it is called Aparokshanubhuti. So, you suppose you listen to the words. Is it jnanam? No. You now know the words, their spelling you know, and the dictionary meaning also you know. So, that is not jnanam. So then, you analyze the words and draw some conclusions also. That means what? You are listening to the words, you are understanding the meaning of the words. This is not yet shravanam complete. Because it is the ears which listen to the words and it is the intellect which understands the words. So still the distance is there. It is not knowing yet. So, in fact, you have to cross that portal of listening to the words and understanding the words. As long as you hold on to the words and their meaning, you have not understood. So, suppose the doctor says, this is the one example I got, till I get a better example. The doctor says you are healthy. You have heard the word healthy. You know its dictionary meaning also. Is it enough? No. That health, what the doctor is talking about, is you. Till then, healthy, healthy. Or healthy, ha is kantha, a is talu. So it is a word, that this is what you listen to, sounds you listen to, the meaning you know, but the truth of that word, the word has a truth associated with it, it signals a truth, and it has a meaning, but more than the meaning, it is the truth of yourself, and that you can only be. That is aparoksha anubhuti. Anyway, So this is anubhava bhyam sanyojya. So this gentleman, he has really assimilated it. Then nishchitam, now he knows. Yah pashyati sa pashyati. One who knows, knows it. When you are looking at the bird on the tree, two people are seeing it, one sees it, the other doesn't see. One who sees it. So nishchitam. Then having understood the spirit of that statement, he uses his own language. He is not restricted to any particular language. Vakyantarena avochat. He need not again say viditat. He need not say. Yes, he is a different person, you know. As a person, there is difference, body, mind, etc. Vastu is one. So vakyantarena, he uses his own language. He doesn't use the language of the teacher. He vakyantarena, what is that? Nona vedeti vedacha. In fact, the teacher's language is very, very simple. Whereas this gentleman's language is a bit more complicated, really speaking. Nona vedeti vedacha. It is our projection. What he said, that is there in the Shruti. So he says, na veda iti na. Veda iti na, na veda iti na. No na veda iti veda cha, iti cha vochata. Why he should say this? He could have walked away, you know, having understood the truth, sakshatkara, he could have walked away. No, acharya buddhi samvadartham. We may have to say that. Vakyantarena, no na veda iti veda cha. Ityavochat acharya buddhi samvadartham manda buddhi grahana vyapohartancha. So vakyantarena avochat. He said it in an entirely different sentence. So the purpose is acharya buddhi samvadartham. So samvada is saying the same thing. Sam vadati, samyag vadati. When the truth is spoken, it can only be spoken in one truth only can be spoken. There are no two truths. There is only one truth. So, Acharya has said Anyadeva, etc. And the Sishya, he is concluding the same thing. Upakrama upasamhara. Upakrama means the beginning statement is that of the Acharya. And upasamhara, the concluding means it's not that the entire thing is concluded. In a way. So, because between the Acharya said, he did not understand, then he understood, then he is saying. So, in a way, it is a conclusion within that small thing. So, and upasamhara is nona vedeti vedacha. So, the language of upakrama and upasamhara, upakrama is the beginning, upasamhara is conclusion. The language is different, but vastu is same. That is the samvada. So, Acharya can rest assured that tatpariyavagamam means the tatpariyam has to be taken. Always we say tatpariyam. So, you see, in poetics we describe these things. There is a thing called abhidha, vakyam. In the vakya, in the statement, there is a vritti, the function of the statement. Vritti is a function. The statement is vakya. What is the function of the statement? To convey a meaning. That is the function. So, abhidha. So, Ramaha Ravanam Ahanat. Rama killed Ravana. What a big deal. That is abhidha. What it means nothing more than that. That is abhidha. Then there is a lakshana. Shakhayan Chandraha. Shakhayan Chandraha is not like Ramaha Ravanam Ahanat. So, on the tree branch, there is the moon. So that is not lakshana, that is not abhidha, because abhidha becomes meaningless there. Also, Gangayam Ghoshaha, a hamlet in the river. Hamlet cannot be there in the river. River is the flow of water. So there abhidha, the immediate meaning of the sentence, the direct meaning of the sentence doesn't work. You have to go around it, go around the words and their meaning. And then tatpariyam. It is something more than abhidha also. What is the tat parata? Means the intent you have to pick up. The statement only signals the truth. It doesn't say the truth in so many words. It signals the truth. And you listen to the statement, you understand the meaning, and you take the spirit of it. Tatparyam. So, between the teacher and the student, tatparyam is fixed. Nona vedeti, tatparyavagamartham. That is what the Tikakara says. So, tatparya between the student and the teacher, the intent is understood. Words are different. The intent is understood. Vivaksha we call. Vaktum iccha. The thing that is desired to be conveyed. Anyway, that is one thing. So, to establish this kind of samvada between the teacher and the student, so the student came to this teacher and said what all he said. Then there is another purpose. Manda buddhi grahanam vyapohārthañca. So, anyadeva tadviditāt. It is what the teacher said. You just listen to it and say, it is not available for knowing. So, anyadeva tadviditāt. It is not something to be known. Therefore, forget about it. Ignore it. Leave it. Jnanam, Atma, so yato vacho nivartante apraapya manasasaha. Words cannot describe it, mind cannot speculate it. Okay, forget about it. Mind and words can do something. Words, recitation and offering of the oblations, etc., we can do karma. And mind can visualize a few things and do upasana. So we can really engage ourselves in karma and upasana. This is jnanam. If it is beyond the words and mind, then we may as well leave it alone. That kind of a notion should not be there in the students. So one may conclude like that. Manda buddhi, they say this. No, it is not for us. So manda buddhi vyapohartham. Manda buddhi grahanam vyapohartham. So atma, he just takes the immediate meaning. Aviditam. Atma is not to be known. Leave it. It cannot be known. Leave it. He doesn't understand. Maybe there is something to it. So, that kind of a mandabuddhi can be there. And he may have that kind of a wrong understanding. Grahana is understanding. To negate it, so to reject it, so that even a simple person can think of trying to understanding it. So, that is the idea of mandabuddhi vyapohārthañca. Next verse. So this discussion about known, not known thing will be there for one more mantra. And then we will enter into a new territory. So you just stay with me for one more mantra. The same kind of discussion will be there. Let us say that. Yasya matam tasya matam. Matam yasya na vedasaha. Avijñātam vijānatāṁ, vijñātam avijānatāṁ. Yasya matam saha na veda. Did I leave it or something? Let us say the avatarika. Shishyacharya samvadat. That is the vakyam. Tathache gajjitam upapannam bhavati. I don't have it in my book. Okay, doesn't matter. So let me explain that also. So, one, you see, now that really connects also in a way. You see, acharya's upakrama, beginning vakyam, is what? Aviditam. So, anyadeva tadviditat. That is the upakrama, beginning sentence, opening statement. Then the concluding statement, upasamhara, is nonavedeti vedacha. Then comes just that leaves one more statement there. That is yonas tadveda tadveda. That part. Nonavedeti vedacha is there. It is there before and ending also. But yonas tadveda tadveda is the garjanam. That is the garjanam. Nonavedeti vedacha is not garjanam. It is just a statement which is parallel to what the teacher told. Samvada vachanam. But yonas tadveda tadveda, that is really a garjanam only. Because among us, who knows? What is it? It is garjanam only. This garjanam, this clarion call, this thundering statement, it is meant for mandabuddhi grahana vyapohartham. Acharya buddhi samvadartham, yona vedeti vedacha is enough, but for mandabuddhi's sake, so to shake a person and to put him on the right direction, the garjanam has a purpose. So upapannam bhavati, the garjitam. So this thundering statement, statement like a thunder, it also is very appropriate and it is in the fitness of things. Upapannam bhavati. Now avatarika. Sishyacharya samvadat pratinivrutya svena rupena shrutihi samasta samvada nivruttam arthameva bodhayati. Yeah, it is not nivruttam, sorry. Samasta samvada nirvruttam. Nirvruttam. There is a big difference in meaning. Nivruttam doesn't fit, it is nirvruttam. Arthameva bodhayati. Yasya matam ityadina. So up to this point, so yonas tadveda tadveda nona veda eti veda cha. It was a dialogue between the teacher and the student. Now the dialogue is over. That's why we said upakrama, upasamhara, etc. The opening statement, concluding statement, dialogue is over. So if the dialogue is over, now who is speaking this? The Shruti is speaking. Sometimes it is like this. An author, while explaining a situation, he introduces a dialogue. He says, let us now consider a dialogue between a doctor and a patient. And then doctor, patient, like that dialogue is given. Now the dialogue is over. So from this dialogue, we can understand who is saying now. Is he doctor saying or patient saying? No. Is the author saying? Similarly, here, in the place of author, we have Shruti. Shruti is the author here. It replaces the author. So, Shrutihi bodhayati. Arthameva bodhayati. So, samasta samvada nirvruttam. This dialogue between, samvada is dialogue between the teacher and the student. It started with anyadeva tadviditat. Then the teacher said, I knew it. Then the student said, I knew it. The teacher said, what you knew is very little. Then he went along with it and finally said what he knew. And that was true. And also a garjanam to take care of some simple-minded people. All that is there. Now the dialogue is over. Shruti takes over. And by taking over the bodha, the teaching it to its own hands, by withdrawing from the dialogue, pratinivrutya, sishyacharya samvadat pratinivrutya. So dropping the dialogue there and withdrawing from the dialogue, now Shruti is presenting the subject matter in direct sentence statement. Directly it is telling, bodhayati. Is it teaching something new? No. The dialogue was presented earlier. Now what is the pindi kurtarthaha? What is the distilled meaning of this dialogue? So samasta samvada nirvruttam arthameva. There was a back and forth dialogue. Teacher, student, again student and the teacher. Like that there is a dialogue. So all this dialogue, samasta samvada is all this dialogue. Nirvruttam artham. So this dialogue, as you carefully look at it, it gives us a truth, artham, a truth it presents. That truth is taken out, distilled out of that dialogue and presented by the Shruti before us. That is, yasya matam tasya matam, matam yasya navedasaha. You see, matam has two meanings. So, one meaning is, matam is a concept. Matam means a concept. Opinion, they say. A concept or an opinion. Now, yasya matam saha naveda, second half of the sentence. So, for a person who has a concept of Brahman, he doesn't know Brahman. The idea is very critical. What all we hold on to are so many concepts. And a concept can never be the truth. You see, a gentleman asked me, Swamiji, in your opinion, very real I am telling, back in India we have this kind of issues also. The issue is, Swamiji, in your opinion, is not Vishnu superior to Shiva? That is what he asked. Vishnu is a god. Shiva is another god. So, it is what kind of... I don't have a parallel in to give an example. Only you have to take like this only. So, is not Vishnu superior to Shiva? That is the question he asked me. In a kind of a class-like situation only he asked. Then I gave an answer to him. You see, in my life I did not meet Vishnu, I did not meet Shiva. Not only that, as far as I know, my father also, he doesn't seem that he met any one of them. Leave alone both, my grandfather also did not meet. In my opinion, if that kind of a meeting had it occurred, it would have been recorded in the family history. In our family, in any number of generations I look back, we did not seem to meet either Vishnu or Shiva. And therefore, how do I know? I have to meet at least both of them, at least one time each I have to meet. Then only I can tell who is superior to whom. Then he asked, Swamiji, what is all that you are saying? I said, yeah, what kind of question it is? So, you hold on to a few concepts. Vishnu is what? Vishnu is the name given to a reality on a particular basis, and you understand the spirit of the name, etc., then it's okay. You are with the truth. Shiva also, the same truth is there, another name given to the truth in another situation. Incidental names, these are all. The truth is nameless. You should know all that. Then if you know all that, Vishnu, Shiva are the names to a nameless reality given an incidental situation, etc. If you know all that, then the question will not be there. The question, so you have an idea of Vishnu. Vishnu means he lives in Vaikuntha, as if he knows what is Vaikuntha. He lives in Vaikuntha, he has one or two wives and a few children, etc. And he has a very funny looking vehicle and all that. So this is Vishnu. And then Shiva is even worse. Now you want to know who is superior to whom. So you are trying to compare the two of your own ideas. Between them you want to decide which is superior. So a concept and an idea of Brahman is not Brahman. So matam yasya, yasya matam, for whom there is a concept or an opinion of the truth, sahana veda. He doesn't know. So, I know Brahman. Suppose a person has this notion, he is thinking that I know Brahman. That means he did not really know Brahman. He has only formed a concept of Brahman. And then I have seen another situation. I say what I seen. One gentleman told me, I was observing an acharya. He says, like this, he hits the table with the fist. This is the emphasis. So I do shapatham, means I take a vow. One time, two times, three times. Vow. Vishnu is superior to all gods. In Kakinada, one gentleman said this. A town, a coastal town. Then, so he thinks that he knows Brahman, the truth. He thinks he knows, but when he thinks that, because this kind of a statement, this kind of an attitude can come from a notion of that knowing, I know it, you all don't know, I know it. So, this kind of a person, when he thinks that he knows Brahman, he only formed a concept of the truth. He does not know the true Brahman truly. On the other hand, who truly knows Brahman, he knows that he cannot know Brahman through his sense organs and the mind. మతం. మత మనస్ ఆల్ ఆల్ రిలేటెడ్. ఎస్య మతం, హూ నో, హూ ట్రైస్ టు నో త్రూ ది మైండ్, విత్ ది మైండ్ ఐ విల్ నో. వాట్ ఎవర్ యూ నో విత్ ది మైండ్ విల్ బి, ఐ టెల్ యూ, విత్ ఇన్ ది కన్ఫైన్స్ ఆఫ్ థింకింగ్ అండ్ పెర్సీవింగ్. వాట్ ఎల్స్ ఇట్ కెన్ బి? దేర్ ఫోర్ whosoever decides, who thinks that he knows the Brahman through the sense organs, perception and mind, conception, over. You do not have any more about it. So, such a person, he doesn't know the truth. But who knows that Brahman is the reality which cannot be known through sense organs and mind, he knows. That means he keeps the Brahman. ఎతో వాచో నివర్తంతే అప్రాప్య మనసాసః. సో నౌ హీ నోస్. యస్య అమతం తస్య మతం. ఫర్ హూమ్ ద బ్రహ్మన్ ఇస్ నాట్ ఎ కాన్సెప్ట్, ఇట్స్ నాట్ ఎన్ ఐడియా, ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ సంథింగ్ రిజల్ట్ ఆఫ్ స్పెక్యులేషన్, ఆర్ ఆల్ స్పెక్యులేషన్ హ్యాస్ ఇట్స్ బేసిస్ ఆన్ పర్సెప్షన్. వితౌట్ పర్సెప్షన్ దేర్ కెన్ బి నో స్పెక్యులేషన్. ఐ టెల్ యూస్, ప్రత్యక్షం ఇట్ ఈస్ ది ఆల్ ఎన్కంపాసింగ్ ఓవర్వెల్మింగ్ ప్రమాణ. ఇట్ ఈస్ all you think you are speculating, but all speculation has a pratyaksham as the basis. Therefore yasya amatam tasya matam, he alone knows. And then the word matam, the concept, or this concept, suppose I have an idea or concept of the truth, then what happens? I have a few followers, this head nodding followers. They just follow the person, and an overall impression that the person generates, so they follow it. They are people, common people. They go by appearances, so they follow. And then they form as a group around the person. And now, so his concept or his idea, earlier it was his own concept. Now it becomes a matam, religion. It acquires the shape of an organ. What is a religion? It is an organized concept. You hold on to a concept and organize a number of people around that concept. That is matam. So, matam yasya, who has this matam, sahana veda. You can say, you can accommodate everything. So a religion can be a stepping stone to reality if it is not dissociated or segregated from philosophy. Religion should never be segregated from philosophy. Religion is rituals. There are three things: religion, rituals, mythology and philosophy. Three things. So rituals, mythology, like Puranic stories, some stories, the churning of ocean, Avatara, this kind of, this or that, all stories. Rama and Krishna are not stories, they are historic. But they are converted into mythological situation. Only historic things, over a time they become mythological. So Christ is historic, but becomes mythological. King David is historic, but becomes mythological. So like that. So, this is mythology. Everything is has its place, no problem. We need some mythology also. If we don't have proper mythology, then we will have to invent Harry Potter and Spider-Man. So, mythology has its glory. So, you just suspend the logic and start enjoying it, if you can. That is mythology. And philosophy. So, these three. There should be no segregation. So, this mata people, you know, this concept people, They don't have any inner freedom to raise above the concept. They just don't have that inner freedom. That's why they now fix themselves to this concept and now start organizing that concept. Before he starts organizing it, he has a chance, small or big chance, of raising above the concept. He has a chance. A little more prarabdha works in his favor. A little more proper thinking, etc., that incisive thinking is there, he can raise above the concept and understand it as a concept and be satisfied with it. But he organizes over. Now the chance of rising above is gone. So you organize a thing, you become prisoner of that organization. Very big problem. So, these matas, the so-called religions, they are like that. Matam yasya na vedasaha. So, concept, matam is a concept of the religion, is nothing more than a concept. Instead of being an individual concept, it is a group concept. It is an organized concept, that is the religion. So, yasya matam na vedasaha. Not only that, if you do not organize the concept, probably it can be examined and it can be followed also, but once you organize, what is this organization? You are isolating a segment of the society from the rest of the society. So, I am a Shaiva. So, in India, you see this, the religious divide you see, my God, it is such a dangerous thing, it is such a painful thing. So in the office, government office, there is a Hindu, a Muslim and a Christian. They are all mixed thing. Indian society, it presents a kaleidoscopic situation. And they are working together. In the same team they are working. In the laboratory, some 5-10 people are working. So 2 or 3 are Hindus, 1 Muslim, 1 Christian is there. Now, that fellow Indian feeling, which you find in America. In America, they are fellow Americans. They may be New Yorkers, Californians, they may be Protestants or Catholics. Whatever. Protestants and Catholics, they are like almost two different religions only. It's not, they do not conduct themselves as two different branches of the same religion. They somehow tend to behave as if they belong to two different religions. Whatever. But in the office situation or in the workplace situation, their religion has no relevance. They work like fellow Americans. I wish we have the same situation in India. So, this mata, religion, it divides people. Vertically it divides. So, the fellow Indian feeling, even if it comes into the fore, it is suppressed by this mata feeling. So, similarly, Shaiva, I am Shaivaha. So when he sees this Vaishnava, Dvesham. Dvesham means some negativity, some hostility. I was visiting a temple. Generally, temple means what? Just to do namaskar and move on. But sometimes what happens, I found myself in a queue. There are people before me and people behind me. I thought I will go and visit. So I started going in that there is a barricade, like thing, ropes. Ropes are barricades. So I was going. Then I found there are 20 people before me. Okay. Then I turned behind. There are 20 people behind me also. They collected in the meanwhile. Okay. I stood there. We are moving forward. The person before me is a Vaishnava. Vertical. And the temple is a vertical temple, it is, not a horizontal. Whereas I am a horizontal guy. So what happened, that Pujari, he saw this Vaishnava before me. He is giving some Tirthaman Prasadam to everybody. Then when he saw this Vaishnava, he said, Vango, Namaskar, this and that. So he went inside and brought one coconut piece and one mala. And Sesha Vastram they call. Means a piece of cloth, a new cloth, offered to the Lord. He brought all these things and gave it to him. He did not know him. He asked, what is your name, where from you came and all that. So they are not known to each other. Only the Namam is the signal, that's all. Then I came. I am a sadhu. I have some very special dress also. So he just put that Tirtham in me, move on, like that. So this is the matam. So that matam, that sense of group loyalty, that is the matam. Group loyalty, not necessarily religion all the time, group loyalty. They ask, to which sampradaya do you belong? I went to a Mahatma. He's a very big thing and there are hundreds of people. Just I went to pay my respects. Because he's a Mahatma, I can pay my respects. So, even before I entered inside, the Mahatma's secretary asked me, to which sampradaya do you belong? I tell, I belong to the sampradaya of Vedavyasa and Shankara. Then he said, no, not that. You are not answering my question. Like that. So, then caste. So, aham kshatriyaha, I am a kshatriya. Therefore, I am not spontaneous brotherhood is not possible. Is possible with another kshatriya, but not with other caste people. Matam. Any concept you hold on to, it can bind. It can cover up the truth. Similarly, matam need not be organized religion only. Any group loyalty, any cult-based loyalty or sectarian thinking, matam, it is not the truth. Not only up to that point, I can even go one step and say, matam, a concept. You take yourself to be a grahastha, I take myself to be a sannyasi. So, that means grahasthas have a particular attitude towards sannyasis and then another different attitude towards other grahasthas. Sannyasis have a particular attitude towards other sannyasis but a different attitude towards grahasthas. I am not saying anything against practicality of living and all that. Practically, whatever we have to do, we do. That's okay. But intrinsically, you are sure that you are a sannyasi and all others are grahasthas? And they are sure that they are grahasthas and therefore sannyasis, brahmacharis? So what is all this? If you are sure that you belong to a given category, a group, you do not know the truth. In fact, grahasthas say, oh, he is a sannyasi, let us leave him alone. Then sannyasis may, in a given situation, sannyasi may say, oh, these are all grahasthas. For them, probably they don't need this truth and all that. He can say, no, let them have their way. Why should I tell them the truth? Probably I think like that. So this way, so a concept, grahastha, sannyasi, what are these? They are not intrinsic to Atma. So if you get committed to these matas, concepts, ideas, Naveda. The point is, one Mahatma used to ask, kya sab kuch manyataon ko chhodne ke liye tayyar ho? Like that he used to ask. Are you ready to just drop off all concepts and ideas about yourself, about the world, and about Ishvara? These are the 3 points in Vedanta. We are not against your concept of this party, that party. You may have social life, all that is not the issue here. Here the issue is Atma, Brahma, Jagat. So with reference to Atma, Brahma and Jagat, we do have a number of concepts. Are you willing to drop every one of them, lock, stock and barrel, to cast off? Are you ready? No. We are having them since some time. How can we do that? Matam yasya na vedasaha. You will not know the truth. Then one more step I will go. There are many collective thinking patterns with us. In fact, all group loyalties, etc. are based on such patterns only. Collective thinking patterns. Like, I am a human being. So, we fear what everybody else fears, so we are supposed to fear it, therefore we fear it. We like what everybody else likes, so we are supposed to like it, so we like it. So this kind of a hairstyle, now it is fashion, everybody is having this kind of a hairstyle, so I should have that hairstyle. So suppose you go to India, different hairstyle, here different hairstyle, so I am supposed to have this hairstyle, I am supposed to wear this kind of a shirt, because everybody wears it. So this way, I gave some silly examples, but suppose this kind of a collective thinking pattern is more deep than this shirt and hairstyle. Shirt and hairstyle is okay, but if it is a little deeper than that, then you will not know the truth. I tell you, you should drop all ideas, all concepts about yourself and about Brahman, and about Jagat, and keep entirely open, then possible you will know the truth. So yasyamatam tasya matam. Yasya matam matam yasya navedasaha. Let us see what Bhashyakara says. Yasya brahmavidaha amatam avijnatam aviditam brahma iti matam abhiprayaha nischayaha tasya matam. Yasya amatam tasya matam. Yasya nischayaha. Matam is nischayaha. Matam abhiprayaha nischayaha. Abhiprayaha means an opinion. Nischayaha means a very pakka opinion it is. What is that? Brahma, aviditam brahma. Amatam brahma, avijnatam brahma, aviditam brahma. Three words are used because Shruti uses the three words. So, amatam brahma, avijnatam brahma, aviditam brahma. Three mean the same. But you can have different levels also. An organized religion is not brahma. A collective thinking pattern is not brahma. Your individual conception is not brahma. And the one who is sure of this, amatam brahma, aviditam brahma, avijnatam brahma, tasya matam. Now, what is this matam? He says, jnatam samyak brahma ityabhiprayaha. So, yasya, for whom? So, to whom? Yasya brahmavidaha. He is the brahmavid really. He knows the brahman. So, to whom? Amatam avijnatam aviditam brahma. You see, the growth should be like this in the knowledge of Brahman. So to start with, I am a human being and I am the body, mind, etc. But now I understand that I am not the body. I further know I am not a mere bundle of sensations. Sense organs, you know, identity with them will be there. I am not a bundle of sensations. I am not a picture created by thoughts and emotions. Thoughts and emotions, they create, they spin an imaginary world. And they create an imaginary world and make the person a part of that imaginary world. So that is what emotions do. The world created by these emotions and thoughts, it is a utterly false world. And it creates a world and I become a part of that also. So a totality is created and I create this totality with all my emotions and thoughts. And then I become a part of that totality. I am the creator of the totality and I am creator of the part also. The world is entirely built up of thoughts and emotions. So now I recognize that I am not a bundle of thoughts and emotions. So that is the growth. So the wisdom lies in separating the Atman. Separating means the discriminating, discerning, viveka. You have to discern the Atman from the whole apparatus of mind and body. From the what the psychosomatic apparatus presents before us is false. There is nothing to do with reality. You come to that level, yasya amatam saveda, he knows. Otherwise, this psychosomatic apparatus, it creates an imaginary world and we start believing in it. So, then he knows. A raw human being, raw means no growth, he identifies with the physical body. An educated human being identifies with emotions and intellection. There is a wise man, he just doesn't identify with all of these things. He abides in total disidentification, in immortal awareness. Therefore, You see, Atman can only be described in negation. As uncaused, you can say as uncaused, independent, non-dependent, unrelated. Atman is not related to a few things, unrelated, undivided, unreachable by effort. So like this, you can describe. That doesn't mean that Atman is such a utopian, nebulous thing. No. Even while describing Atman entirely in negation, the fact remains that Atman is supremely actual. It is accessible, attainable and realizable now and here, because it is the only truth. So one has to approach it that way. Hold on to a few concepts and a few words and a few notions and some collective thinking patterns and some emotions, as if the emotions are very sacred, and then a few intellections, etc. You will not know the truth. You will continue, you means not you people. We will continue in our false world. So, one who knows avijñātam, amatam, aviditam brahmā iti, samyak brahma jñātam, he knows the Brahman very correctly. So, you are not going to know the Brahman with the mind. It is just not possible. So, amatam it is. Matam means manu avabodhane. Manu is the verbal root. Manu avabodhane. Manu te iti mananam. So the act of thinking is mananam. Manu te anena iti manaha. The instrument of thinking is manaha, the mind. Manute in the passive voice, whatever it is, iti matam. So what is thought? Yeah, manu ta. That taprachayam, you know, past participle. That is vidita, vidita, vidita. Ishita, ishita. It should be ishta, it is ishita. So like that, gam ta, gata. Kru ta, krata, the done. So mata, the known. With the mind. That is the matam. So matam is what? You use this mind as a tongs and a hold to something. That is matam. So that way, whatever is held by the tongs of mind, that is matam. Past participle. So that way, whatever is held by you with the tongs of mind, that is not Brahman. So, you see, I tell you an example. A driver sat in his car and he is driving. He cannot run himself down by the car. That is how it is. If the driver sitting in the car and driving it, the day he can run himself down, that day you will know the Brahman with the mind. So, the day the salt doll goes into the Mahatma, Indian Mahatmas are like that. The salt doll is a famous thing, every Mahatma talks of it. A salt doll, it wanted to know the depth, estimate the depth of the ocean. It declares to other salt dolls, "Oh dolls, I will go and find the depth of the ocean," because they are all afraid of the ocean and its depth. This salt doll said, "I will find out it." And so it goes into the ocean and comes back, finds out the depth and comes back and reports the depth to all other salt dolls. So when that happens, we will know Brahman with the mind. So yasya matam tasya matam. Then yasya punarmatam jnatam viditam maya brahmeti nischayah na vedaiva saha na brahma vijanati saha. So yasya punaha. So whosoever says matam, jnatam, viditam, instead of saying amatam, ajnatam, avijnatam, aviditam, instead of saying that, this gentleman says punaha, on the other hand, matam, jnatam, viditam, he says. So in fact, some people make all kinds of claims also. So they say, we have seen Brahma, we have known Brahma, all kinds of claims they make. And you see, one gentleman, he says, I am returning from Himalayas, and I did a penance there, and for 30 years without food. At that time, I have suspended all my metabolic processes, therefore I did not age. Before going to the tapas, not 30 years, 100 years. Before going to the tapas, I was 60 years old. Now also I am 60 years old because I did not age for 100 years because I suspended metabolism. And then I have had a sakshatkar of Brahman. And he says that. He also said, I was taught Gita by Sri Krishna directly. During that time, I did not age, and I was taught Gita by Sri Krishna directly. So this is what he told. Then in the audience there was one gentleman, one young man. He told, sir, this is Sri Krishna while teaching Gita to you, did he use our Gita Press book or did he use some other book? That is what he asked. Then the Mahatma became angry. He did not understand, but then he understood it. So, matam yasya, jnatam viditam maya brahma iti nishchayaha, saha na vedaiva. He did not know at all, na brahma vijanati saha. He is not knowing Brahman and he is not going to know Brahman also. Okay, then there is another vakyam. Avijñātam vijānatam vijñātam avijānatam. What to do with all these vakyas? So, now Shruti is presenting a contrast between a jñāni and an ajñāni. Vijānan is a jñāni. Vijānatam is Shashti Bahuvachanam. Avijanan is an ajnani. The contrast between a jnani and ajnani. He has told, and the Shruti has told, who is the jnani and who is not the jnani. Yasyamatam, etc. Now a contrast between the two. So, the contrast is vijanatam avijnatam. And Shankara has an introduction to that contrast, avatarika. He says this. Say that. Vidvada vidushoho yathoktau pakshau avadharayati. That is the connection. It must be some connection, you know. So, mata, the word mata, manu, the verb manu is replaced by the verb jnā. Both seem to have the same meaning. So, manu, ta, mata, V is an upasarga. Jnā plus ta. Jnā also avabodhane. Jnā plus ta, jnāta. Then what is the difference between mata and jnāta? So the same thing is repeated. So Shruti, it just used another verb with the same meaning and made another sentence. So it's not like that. Some connection we have to give. So, vidvad avidishoha yathoktau pakshav. There are two pakshas. Paksha means two alternatives, opposite to each other, two parties. Not parties, jnani doesn't have a party, but we have two alternatives. One is vidvat. Vidvat means the jnani, one who knows the truth, one who knows the truth. And then avidvat, avidvat means one who doesn't know the truth. Among these two people, there are two opinions. So one who holds on to this understanding is the jnani. And one who has this understanding, the opposite one, is an ajnani. So these are the two pakshas, two alternatives. They are avadharayati. They are reassertained. One more time. With that, this known, not known thing will be over. One more time, they are reassertained. So just bear with me one more time. So that assertaining will be over. Then we will go into a different territory. So what is that? Avijñātam vijānatāmiti. That is the vākyam. So let us say avijñātam, amatam, aviditameva. Yeah, you carry all the three. Avijñātam, amatam, aviditam. At matam we said, amatam, avijñātam, aviditam. Here also. So as I told you, it's a collective thinking pattern, an individual conception, and then a speculation, whatever. That way you have to organize it. A religious linear truth. So the truth is linear, and I have that truth. My truth is the truth. So this kind of different levels. See, individual, he is an individual, and also he has a role at the social level. So like that, all these ideas, collective ideas, individual ideas, etc., organized ideas, they are all covered by different words of the same meaning. So aviditam, avijnatam, amatam, eva brahma. Brahma cannot be brought into any one of these categories. Individual or collective speculations, collective thinking patterns, etc., Brahma doesn't become an object of any of these things. He knows that. Brahma. Brahma is Atma. You see, in practical terms, very mind-boggling implications. Brahma, Brahma, it's okay. Brahma is beyond everything, all that, okay. But Brahma is Atma. That means a very big thing. As long as you keep everything at a distance and start discussing, so there are so many religions, why that, why there is a conflict between one religion and another religion, they should live in peace. This kind of discussion is all right. But where do you belong? Here the discussion is not about the world and Brahma and all that. So what about you, Atma? You connected to Atma. So when you connected to Atma, the question becomes altogether different. You believe me, it is very difficult. Mind-boggling. The implications are too scary. Means what? Are you ready to drop all definitions about yourself? That is the point. Suppose I define myself as a Brahmana, then amatam, na vijanati. I define myself as a Hindu, as an Indian, as a human being, as a living being. If you define yourself as a living being, the definition will come in the way, because you are separating yourself from the entire so-called non-living world, and now you have a categorization, living, non-living, that kind of a categorization. Even biology doesn't accept this categorization. Some high school biology may accept it, but if you go to university biology doesn't accept this living, non-living categorization. Whereas you end up in that categorization, you will not know the truth. So, you should refuse to define yourself at all, utterly undefining about oneself, then you will slowly begin to awaken like that. That's why applying to oneself is very difficult. We can discuss about the world, society, so these are Republicans, these are Democrats, these are Bharatiya Janata Party, these are Congress Party, this is this religion, that religion. Like that you can make a social thesis. All that is different. Now, are you similarly defining yourself or not? So you define the world and you define yourself. So, no, there is chaos in the world. Where is chaos in the world? There is no chaos in the world. There is chaos in your mind. There is conflict in the world. There is conflict in your mind. There is terrorism, there is war in the world, there is war in your mind. So, that's why all conceptions, all ideas must be ruthlessly rejected and remain just stark without anything. You begin to awaken. That is the implication. So, whereas we find even certain simple definitions, they hold on to us so strongly that we are not able to rise above some silly definitions, some caste-based, color-based, nationality-based definitions, whatever we have. So we get stuck in those definitions. where is the question of knowing the Brahman? Okay. Vijanatam. Then, samyag viditavatam ityetat. So, samyag viditavatam brahma aviditameva. Those who know the Brahman very correctly, very really, for them Brahman remains a truth that cannot be conceptualized, that cannot be categorized, that cannot be defined. That is amadat, amatam, aviditam, avijnatam. I am giving you some English translations. That cannot be conceptualized, it cannot be opinionated, all ideations do not touch the Brahman, all conceptions do not touch the Brahman. That is the Atma. So, those who know this way, they know the Brahman. I tell you, suppose you sit alone and start dropping of all the definitions. Whatever definition you remember and drop it. Just as an experiment. Some kind of a laboratory experiment. So, drop it. And as you go on dropping wholeheartedly, see what happens. You see, Atma, it cannot be defined in any word. In any positive statement you cannot define it. But you operate all the negations, what all you can remember. You see, when I say these things, I bring in at least 4, 5, 6, like that I reel out a few negations, uncaused, undivided, uncategorized. So, like that, non, in, all kinds of negative words I say. You just try it. You just negate, go on negating and then go on dropping all ideas. When you start doing it, the truth, it comes to you, you merge in the truth, which is so solid, rock-like reality. You will merge in it. It is like that. That's why I say, even while saying it is avijñātam, it is not known, amatam, it doesn't come under the scope of mind and senses, even while saying it, I also say, do not think it is some nebulous thing, etc. It is utterly realizable. It is attainable. It is you can access it now and here. You are it. So, as you do it, you rise above the body identification and then you begin to awaken. Then the truth is very solid it is. When you say, I am, is there any looseness about that I am? Is it a loose thing? Is it not dense like a rock, like monolithic awareness it is? Does it appear loose to you? No. Is there anything which is more real than that awareness when you are I am? Is there anything more real than that? No. Unfortunately, we identify with the world and this silly world starts appearing real to us. Once you know that your reality, then the world appears like a mist, like a moon in the daytime. So, it is truly accessible to you. That is how it is understood. Then, indriya mano buddhishveva atma darshinam ityarthaha. So, asamyak darshinam avijnatam. Avijanatam, vijnatam viditam brahma, next sentence is vijnatam viditam brahma, avijanatam asamyagdarshinam. So asamyagdarshi, samyagdarshi, asamyagdarshi. Samyagdarshi is one who knows the truth, one who sees the truth. Seeing is knowing. So knowing is, you know what I mean. So asamyagdarshi means one who doesn't see the truth. So for this asamyagdarshi, one who doesn't see the truth, he says vijnatam brahma. He says, I know Vishnu, I know Shiva. You see, that example I gave, who is superior, Vishnu or Shiva? To ask that question, he must have known Vishnu and Shiva, both he must have known. He thinks that he has known Vishnu and he has known Shiva. Then only he asks the question. It is like asking, suppose there are two presidents in history. Which president is greater than the other? Like that you ask. Then you read some history and you can answer. Like that. So, who is superior, Vishnu or Shiva? As if you know both of them. So, this is the asamyak darshi. And so for them it is vijñātam. It appears to be known, something which is known, which is knowable. So like that. It is wrong. Who are these asamyak darshis? Probably. Can you explain that word? Avijānatam. Those who do not know. Why they do not know? Probably how they do not know? What could be the reason for not knowing? He says, Indriyamano buddhishveva atmadarshinam ichyarthaha. I told you already. I anticipated and told in so many words. So you have this apparatus, sense organs, so which produce sensations, mind which produces, which throws out continuously thoughts, ideations, intellections, conceptions, all kinds of things it will be throwing up. And so, Indriya Manaha, Buddhi, ideations and intellections. So, all they create all these sensations, ideations and intellections. Indriya Mano Buddhi, all of them together create an imaginary world. And we think that is the truth. Indriya Mano Buddhi Shveva Atma Darshinam. So they take the body, mind, sense complex and the various pieces of knowledge or knowing. They are not knowledge, they are all positive science is in science. So they are not knowledge or any such thing. Only ignorance parading is knowledge. So all these things they throw up and we start taking them to be Atma. This is me, this is mine, this is me, this is mine. People are identified with their concepts, conceptions and intellections more than with their bodies. So I can handle some inconvenience to the body, but if any conception that I hold on to, if somebody steps on it, I become very jittery. I cannot handle that situation. So people, they are very committed, almost bordering on fanatical situation to their ideas. So anybody who is committed to ideas, saying that this set of ideas is the right set of ideas, he doesn't know the truth. Because Indriya Mano Buddhi Shveva Atma Darshinam Ichyarthaha, for him this is the Atma. Here Shankara raises a question. You mean to say avijñātam vijānatam, vijñātam avijānatam, avijānatam vijñātam. Those who do not know Brahman, know Brahman. It sounds like that, you know. So vijñātam avijānatam. So then the question is, what could be the difference between a Brahmajñāni and a mosquito? Now there is no difference. Because you ask, he is a Brahmajñāni. Does he know Brahman? No. Because avijñātam avijānatam. If he is a Brahmajñāni, then he, Brahman is not known. Avijñātam avijānatam. Then, so, could you follow the question? So, if he is a Brahmajñāni, so he knows Brahman. That means, he doesn't know Brahman. So, avijñātam avijānatam. Vijānatam avijñātam. Then here is the mosquito. Does it know Brahman? No. Then what is the difference between a Brahmajnana and a mosquito? The difference is, Brahman, if it is known, that is not knowledge of Brahman. Anybody who claims Brahman is to be known, he doesn't know Brahman. Only one who says and knows that Brahman cannot be known alone knows Brahman. This truth is known to Brahmajnani, whereas this truth is not known to fly. Why the fly doesn't know this truth? Because it just doesn't have a situation to consider this blessed thing called Brahman. It just doesn't have a situation. A person claims that he knows Brahman, so he is considering Brahman. Then another person stands beside him and tells, sir, Brahman is not something that can be known. So better understand that you cannot know Brahman. Between them, this person who says Brahman cannot be known knows Brahman. This gentleman who says Brahman Brahman is known to me doesn't know Brahman. Between them, but not a person in Manhattan who doesn't care, who cares two hoots for this blessed thing called Brahman, who is not interested in any Brahman, etc., who is too busy with his sense pleasures, he is not the issue here. What about him? He is not the issue. We are not talking about him. Achyanta bhogaparayanas, they are not the topic here. So, this person knows physics, this person doesn't know physics means that kind of a statement. Will you make it with a university physics student and some businessman selling pawn outside? Will you compare like that? No. In the same class, between two students of physics, you can make a comparison. For those people who are so totally committed to sense pleasures and they are, for them, the word Brahman itself is not their concern. They are not the issue here. Not flies and mosquitoes are the point here. Point here is, those of us who try to know Brahman, it is very possible that we end up assuming that we know Brahman without really knowing Brahman. That possibility has to be negated, otherwise the students will suffer. Welcome back. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om Tatsat Shri Krishnarpanamastu.